everyone, and welcome to the morning show right here on the new Main Street TV. We are so happy you're here with us this morning, or if you're watching our replay at night, welcome also. Of course, Jennifer here to start off the morning show with our good friend Pete Wilson and the morning news update, which is sponsored and brought to you by our good friend Nia Henry, agent for Appalachia Realty. And if you are having any real estate questions running through your mind or have any real estate needs for that matter, please give Nia a call at 740-418-4135 and she will work hard for you. All right, Pete, it's always fun to talk to you on a Monday because, well, there's always a lot of stuff that happens over the weekend.
Right. Well, we normally talk every day during the weekday and then, Monday comes around. We didn't talk on Saturday. We didn't talk on Sunday. So I guess maybe that's to be expected.
So we're extra full of it on Mondays.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. You can determine that when I'm done talking. All right.
Okay.
Okay. But anyway, I guess the big news story that broke over the weekend was out of the courthouse. And that is the news that a prominent Jackson defense attorney, we're talking about 49-year-old C. Michael Mike Moore, known best around town as Mike, he has been indicted and arrested. He faces 6 felony-level charges alleging that he engaged in, quote, sexual conduct and, quote, sexual contact with a, quote, child victim in incidences which allegedly occurred in the period, according to the indictment, from June 2012 to December 2015. This indictment was filed on Friday, late on Friday, in Jackson County Common Police Court. There was a warrant issued for Mr. Moore's arrest. He actually turned himself in the way it worked. He is charged with 3 counts of rape and 3 counts of gross sexual imposition that all involve the same child victim. The 3 charges of rape are first-degree felonies. First-degree felony is the highest of the 5 felony levels. The gross sexual imposition charges, one is a third-degree felony and the other 2 are fourth-degree felonies. The investigation that led to this indictment was actually conducted by the Ohio Attorney General's Office and the Ohio BCI. Jennifer Gray, who is with the Attorney General's Office as an Assistant Attorney General, she signed the paperwork and apparently will be acting as a special prosecutor in this case. In concert with the indictment, Judge Christopher Reagan, who is the judge, of course, of our Common Pleas Court here in Jackson, he filed an order recusing himself from the case because obviously Mr. Moore has practiced law in different counties, but principally in Jackson County for quite a number of years. And so there is a professional association at the very least between Mr. Reagan and Mr. Moore. So one of the things that's going to have to happen as this proceeding moves forward is the Chief Justice of the Ohio Supreme Court will have to name a judge to hear this case. Now, one of the things that has to happen pretty soon is what is called a bond hearing. Any defendant, when they're charged and incarcerated, has the right to seek bond. And a judge is the one who decides what that is. So I do know from checking with the Common Pleas Court this morning, a judge has still not been named. They're in search of one. When one is named, and because of a bond hearing and the fact he's incarcerated, it needs to be done soon. We can expect a bond hearing to be held very soon, maybe as soon as tomorrow, it looks like. So, Jennifer, that's what we know. What was on the indictment? It became public record sometime on Friday afternoon.
Yeah, I really don't know. It's so hard when living in a small town can be a blessing and a curse, and it's really hard when you hear of a story like this, and of course the people involved. So that's a rough one.
No, it certainly is. And once again, this is a fundamental thing, but it can be confusing to people. Obviously, we have some very serious charges here, but this is an indictment. This is not a conviction.
And Pete, I'm glad you mentioned that because I had, a lot of folks ask me questions over the weekend, and I don't know any details other than what you reported and what had been reported, but I think it is very confusing for people when, you know, they hear indictment, that just, that basically means what, like there's enough evidence to go to a trial.
That's
it. A, doesn't mean you're guilty guilty.
That's a good simple way to take it. It's not a conviction. A jury or a judge will decide that.
Right.
But there's enough there that it should be adjudicated.
Looked at, yes.
Right, exactly. And you know, in an indictment, an indictment is done by a grand jury as opposed to a petit jury, which is a trial jury. And the grand jury is a secret proceeding. Nobody is allowed to be in there except the principals. And the prosecutor is basically presenting his facts or her facts. So, you know, there is no defense or no rebuttal or anything like that. This is saying, here is what we know. Is there enough to indict? And an indictment does normally result.
Well, and that's the thing, and I know many years ago, and I'm not trying to make a joke of it, but it's true. Dad always used to say you can indict a grape because it's a one-sided, deal because there's no defense there. It's
right. Well, one of the cliche phrases in the criminal justice system, this is generic. I'm not applying it to this case or any other case that we've known about. You can indict a ham sandwich in a grand jury proceeding.
Yep.
Because, you know, you feel like you have evidence anyway for maybe a conviction, and all you're trying to do is get an indictment, you know, with that phrase, probable cause.
Sure.
You know, so
anyway. And this isn't, you know, our opinion one way or the other. Pete, the one question I keep getting asked, and you don't know the answer, but I have to ask you anyway because you're the news guy, and that is, these charges stem from alleged incidents that were, you know, 9, 10 years ago. What has happened? And I assume you don't know the answer, but I have to ask you anyway.
Right. Well,
what has happened in the, you know,
is a very, very fair question, because you're thinking if the allegations are true, and or they could be true, you know, and these are obviously, you know, serious crimes.
These are pretty serious.
What is taking so long? Well,
you're
right. We just don't know. It could be that some of the evidence came out latently, not instantly, not at the time that that it occurred. Prosecutors may have taken their time on the case to investigate it. Because, you know, once you do indict, you know, the clock is ticking.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can't take it back. There is a speedy trial, element to our Constitution, to our federal Constitution. And so there's only a certain amount of time to have a trial and all like that. You've got to have all your ducks in a row.
Right.
For obviously a case like this, there's not a statute of limitations, which often applies to some cases.
Sure.
So, you know, no charges have been brought before in this. Maybe there were allegations. Maybe there's been something else happened along the way to bring this case to light or whatever, or to add to allegations that have been made before. But also, maybe the allegation was not made immediately. Maybe it was made very more recently, you know.
Fair. And
so,
that's,
you know,
right.
Obviously, you know, we're talking about a case that involves things that wouldn't be public, you know, to begin with, that people wouldn't know about them probably. So when information is brought to a prosecutor or to the law enforcement authorities, that's when they start to do something about it. They may take a long time, or maybe they didn't get the information until recently,
right?
As far as the allegations go.
And
so that is just something that we don't know, but a very, very fair question, because a lot of times we do see this on the sex-related cases. Mm-hmm. You know, this happened, you know, 1 year ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago. I mean, how long does it take to bring this to court,
right,
to try to figure out whether something did happen and there should be justice served?
And the other question, and I know you don't know the answer to this either, but it's fair. What about Attorney Moore's clients?
Mm-hmm. Well, I believe that Mike...
I mean, we all know that you know, Mike Moore... has a lot of clients here in our area.
Right. Well, that would be an issue that, you know, he would have to address.
Yeah.
To my knowledge, he practices by himself here in downtown Jackson. His office just across the street, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
And how he would handle that, I don't know. But he has been an attorney for I think about 20 years, close mm-hmm. to 20 years, and has practiced here in Jackson. And I know he's practiced in other counties. He's a prominent defense attorney, so you know that he does have a number of clients. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what happens there.
It's a big old
but
mess.
But obviously, though, they're on hold as far as him being able to do any of that kind of work.
For sure.
Absolutely. All right. Well, moving on, one of the things that will continue to be in the news, Jennifer, is the upcoming special / primary election on May 4th. Not a lot of happening, but a very important issue on the ballot. That's the levy for the Senior Citizen Center in Jackson being put on by the Jackson County Board of Aging. Well, the Jackson County Board of Aging hierarchy and that trio is pretty much composed of Lisa Warrens, who is the Activities Marketing Director, Bill Martin, who is an attorney and also on the Jackson County Board of Aging Board, and Jane Leach, who is the president. They were at the Jackson City Council meeting, the most recent one, on the 12th, and they were at the Wellston City Council meeting on the 15th, and they were making a pitch to the legislators there, to the city officials, letting them know why they're seeking this levy. And I think one of their important messages in Wellston, and this will come out in a story that will have in Wednesday's paper that our associate editor, Phil Buffington, wrote, is they want to assure the folks in Wellston and the folks in Oak Hill that just because they're building a new center in Jackson, that doesn't mean that they're going to close or ignore in any way the Wellston and Oak Hill centers. Jackson is not a big county, and it's one of the few, I understand, that has more than one senior citizen center. Mm-hmm. And that's great, because it's a convenience for the folks in Oak Hill and the convenience for the folks in Wellston. And the levy, they said, will not pay for everything that they want to do, but it will pay for about half of the new senior citizen center in Jackson that they want to build on AC Avenue. But also in the financial package, and it's written into the ballot language, they say, are capital improvements for the Wellston Center and the Oak Hill Center. And the reason, of course, that they want to build the new Jackson Center, that is, that used to be the old Mound Street School. I think it's at least 100 years old. Mm-hmm. It's not very big. Obviously, it's old. They are very service-oriented on their meals and transportation. With that meals program that they have, which has grown, where they, you know, they deliver so many, you know, home-delivered meals, they have to produce so many meals that their kitchen there just can't handle it. The electric service, the amount of room for freezers and coolers, the room they need for staff to prepare the food, it's just not there. Plus, you know, the facility itself is aging, obviously. So that is why they want to build the new center in Jackson. So this was a pitch made at Wellston, and it was a pitch made at Jackson, and we're going to obviously hear a lot more about that, you know, through our media as well. You know, maybe we'll even have a guest here on TV to talk about that levy and why they are seeking it. Okay, we'll go now to the COVID-19 front. Not a lot of new things to report there. We do want to report that the Jackson County Health Department has scheduled two more COVID-19 clinics this week, as we thought they might, because a lot of folks still haven't got their shot. A lot of folks are waiting to get their second shot, or will be taking their second shot soon. These two clinics are set for, the first one is Thursday, that's April 22nd, from 10 a.m. to noon, and 1 p.m. to 7 p.m., it will be at the First Church of the Nazarene. Then back to the First Church of the Nazarene on Saturday again, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. The First Church of the Nazarene is located on 251 Powell Drive in Jackson. Nothing scheduled at any of the schools yet. People scheduled for a second dose of the Moderna or Pfizer vaccine should attend one of these two clinics being held at the Nazarene Church this week. Individuals who are 16 years of age and up are welcome to attend any of these public clinics, including these two, to receive their first dose as well. All right, as far as COVID-19 cases, the Jackson County Health Department, we've not heard from them as far as a case update since last Monday, so I think we will maybe later today, but we haven't heard that yet. In Vinton County, they did make a new report on Saturday, and there is the infographic up. James has put up on the screen for us, if you're watching on television or on your computer. Just one new case, that's the bottom line of those numbers. They went from 729 confirmed cases to 730. The active cases remains the same at 9. The number of confirmed deaths remain the same at 18. That's a total number through the length of the pandemic. which goes back to the end of April in Vinton County. Also, two people hospitalized. That number has not changed either. So not very much change at all in Vinton County. The Vinton County Health Department is doing COVID-19 clinics there at the facility. No set schedule, but it's by appointment only right now. And how you make the appointment, Jennifer, it's that website. If you haven't memorized it yet, let me make sure that I say that right. It's gettheshot.coronavirus.ohio.gov/. Have you got that?
Yeah.
Okay. Just try to think in terms of the words. You know, it's easier. You don't have to think about spelling it out. But there are a couple dots in there to fool you. But, you know, you can see or call up that website about anywhere if you do a little Googling.
You'll Google.
You'll get there.
You'll find it.
Right. And also, we do suppose, although it's not been confirmed yet, that the Forget-Me-Not Center in Zaleski will probably be holding one of those mobile vaccination clinics on April the 28th. The one that was scheduled this past week was not held on the 14th due to the Johnson & Johnson vaccine situation. But it is expected to operate on the 28th. That is its next scheduled appearance there. We'll be confirming that and give you the times and all like that and what type of vaccines that they'll have available. Another cautionary note, Jennifer, in spite of the weather, in spite of the fact that things are happening, in spite of the things, in spite of the fact that there were all sorts of things going on in the county this weekend, the sun is shining, well, most of the time anyway, is the fact that there are still increased cases statewide. Governor DeWine announced at his most recent press conference that the statewide case incidence has now reached 200 cases per 100,000 people.
Pete, we're going the wrong way,
right,
buddy.
Just 4 weeks ago, it was 144 cases per 100,000 people.
I mean, we were talking about, well, it's going to be no time before he opens the state, you know, before we get open back up again. Now we're going the wrong way.
Right. And so, you know, I mean, numbers are what they are. And there are 1,300 people right now that are in the hospital with COVID-19 in the state of Ohio.
Wow.
So, you know, I mean, this thing is not over. You know,
right.
we're doing better. We're out there doing things. I see most people wearing their masks in public places now, maybe better than in the early days of the pandemic. But we just have to We just have to keep at it right now, and the statistics tell us that. All right, as we move on in the news, there was two great events, really more than two great events, but I'm going to tell you about two of them that we attended. One on Friday was the Hug Your Heart Day. Red Thompson was there, and James Hamilton was there, and I have talked with a couple of the organizers, and there is a picture of the organizers, by the way. Four of the principals, and they're worth having their names mentioned. If you're watching on television, I'll identify them from the left there. It's YMCA Executive Director Tim Harvey, Laura Baker of the YMCA, who is one of the co-chairs of the event. Then you have Florence Curtis with the Holzer Health System. She was the other co-chair. And the gentleman on the right is somebody we know within our company. That is Carter Rice, who is the new manager of the Park's Edge Event Center and Stockroom 601. And he ought to be in the picture because the doggone thing was held at the Park Edge Event Center for the first time. It had always been held at the Y before. And as you can see, they had a lot of fun. There are a lot of some of the seniors line dancing. You can see all the room there at the Park's Edge Event Center for the folks to spread out and have fun. Even the line dancers were spaced out there a little bit, as you can see. They had the tables separated out the best they could. People wore masks except when they were seated at their tables. There was a lot of people there, and I think they pulled it off. And here's the bottom line. The seniors had a good time. I know just from talking to a few of them, seeing what was on social media, hearing the reports from Red, who was out there at the Park's Edge Event Center. Remember, a lot of these seniors have not been able to get out. They've not had their activities in the clubs or at the Senior Citizen Center. And it was a great socialization event. In addition to, I mean, how great is it if you go to a place and you get a free lunch, you get free entertainment, you get all the socialization, you could even get free medical screenings.
I mean, that's awesome.
Right. You know, they did all that. And so, you know, our hat is tipped to the Jackson Area YMCA.
Very much.
To Holzer Health System, to all the organizers and volunteers who made it happen. I know that Park's Edge Event Center was delighted to host it, and I know that they were pleased that they were able to have it there. And we are going to bring you literary and pictorial evidence that it was a good time in our Saturday paper. All right, a little bit of a different event held out at Hammertown Lake on Saturday, and that, of course, was the annual Jackson County Trout Festival. Like Hug Your Heart, the Trout Festival was not held last year, so it kind of was a comeback event. That's what the Trout Festival is all about. Look at that little kid right there.
I love that picture.
That young child is Austin Fisher. Is that the right name for him?
It is.
He's 5 years old from Wellston, and he caught that huge crappie. That's not a trout. That's not a bass. That is a crappie. And anyone who knows anything about fishing knows that's a good-sized crappie right there. And he was so proud to hold that up for me for a picture. But Butch Aldridge and Aaron Irvin, who conducted the Trout Festival, they thought the turnout was good. There was great support for their raffle projects. They saw a lot of people having fun. There was a lot of family-oriented fun there. And I'm going to tell you who those folks are right there, because those are the organizers and those are the winners. From the left in that picture, you have FOP Lodge member Scott Hughes. Then you have three of the largest fish winners, Michael Kuhn, Brian Depew, and Mike Pfizer. Then you have FOP Lodge member and event co-chair Butch Aldridge. He, of course, here was on television last week. And you have then you have Whitney Carter, who was one of the young ladies who won a large fish award. And then FOP Lodge member and event co-chair Aaron Irvin. Now, overall, the fishing was great there at Hammertown. All you have to do is take a look at this father-son combination. That is David Christian on the left and his son Tyler Christian on the right. Tyler's, of course, all grown up. He lives away in Athens now. David lives in Jackson, but they got together for a fishing day in Jackson. And as you can see, they call in the fishing business, they limited out. You're allowed to catch no more than 5 trout in a day, and they both have 5 trout there on their stringer. And these are all rainbow trout. A lot of them weigh nearly a pound. So, I mean, it was pretty good fishing all the way around. The organizers considered the Trout Festival a big success. By the way, the largest fish caught there.
That's what I was going to ask you.
It was weird. 1 pound and 12 ounces. It was not a trout. It was not a catfish. It was not a bass, not a crappie. It was a white bass. Now, white bass are not really supposed to be in Hammertown.
I was going to, what the heck is a white bass?
Well, they're in the larger lakes and like that. And, and here's the story that I got on it.
Yeah, how did it get there?
When they put the rainbow trout in the lake, when they stock them, or it might be the sawgeye. When they stalk either the sawgeye or the trout or both, they feed them back at the stocking ponds with white bass fingerlings. So when they're shooting the trout or sawgeye into the lake, there may be some white bass fingerlings that get into the lake with it by mistake.
Oh.
Well, a few of them grow up, and they're pretty good size. I asked Ted Witham, who is the state wildlife officer, who we hope to get up here on TV
soon. Yeah, he's such a fun guy to talk to.
It was a good time when he was up here before. A lot of people were interested in that. Well, Ted told me that they don't mean to put the white bass in there, and they don't expect them to always survive, but that one did. And it's grown to 1 pound and 12 ounces. I suggested, why don't you stalk some white bass?
Yeah, right.
So he laughed and said, maybe they should. But the biggest fish was the white bass, 1 pound and 12 ounces. The biggest trout that was caught was 1 pound and 3 ounces. 1 pound and 3 ounces, and that was caught by Brian Depew of Marietta and Michael Kuhn of Jackson. And so, but there were lots of trout in that 1 pound category, but the largest was 1 pound and 3 ounces. And there were a lot of people catching them. And nobody wants to give their secrets for catching the trout. But I happen to know that some of the most successful people were using a spoon, which is an artificial lure. A lot of people think salmon eggs. A lot of people think worms. A lot of people think corn.
A spoon? Whatever.
But this was a spoon. And the best thing about it is it's artificial, so you don't have to keep rebaiting.
There you go.
All right. There was another great event this weekend. We heard about from, Angelia Hill.
That's
on Friday,
right.
The Jackson County Flea Market did turn out to be a big success. Wasn't the best weather in the world, but it wasn't the worst either. They
Correct.
Did have 200 vendors plus. We're going to give you the whole story on that tomorrow. But since we talked about it ahead of time, I did want to tell you that it came off well. And they feel that it was so successful that they're going to do it again, maybe as soon as May the 15th.
Love it.
So we will tell you more about
How
that and show you some
that?
Pictures tomorrow. Remember last Saturday, they were selling Vills down at Oak Hill for the Festival of Flags.
Yes.
They sold out, and they had to go back and get more Vills, and they ended up selling, I'm told, 230 Vills.
Wow.
Or more, at least 230. So they made a lot of money for the Festival of Flags, and they made a lot of people happy.
Good.
Because, you know, their lunch was a homemade Jackson County Veal. And I do also know, don't have any numbers to give you, but I do know that the smoked chicken dinner that was held in Wellston to benefit the Wellston High School Band also on Saturday was a success as well. Saw a picture of one of the dinners. It looked great. Sorry, I couldn't make it there, but I was out trying to catch a trout instead.
So all right. Were you successful?
No, I was not successful. Never have been successful. I could catch the bluegill like crazy when I was younger, but anybody can do that. But I'll tell you that, they're fun to catch. They ounce for ounce, they'll fight as hard as any fish.
That's right.
All right. The Wellston City Board of Education will be meeting tonight at 7 p.m. I mention this because this is not a regular meeting date for them. They usually meet on the second Monday of each month. So if you're interested, you can go. It will be at the high school. This will be the one of the first in-person meetings they've had in months. I believe the first in-person meeting in at least several months, and it will be open to the public. The Colton Village Council meeting would normally happening tonight, but it was canceled, and their next meeting will be May the 3rd. That's from Colton Mayor Kim Milliken. Early voting is continuing in Jackson County. Jennifer, extended hours at the Jackson County Board of Elections. Once again, this week it's 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The Elections Board office is located at 275 Portsmouth Street in Suite 2. Of course, the big thing on the ballot for people in Jackson County is that senior citizens levy. That's a 0.5 mil additional levy for capital improvements, including the construction of a new senior citizen center in Jackson and capital improvements to both the Oak Hill and Wellston centers. The hours there are 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. All you need to be is a registered voter. You can also do absentee ballots as well as the in-person ballots. All right. Speaking of fundraisers, we want to remind you of the Dinner in the Dust event at the Jackson County Fairgrounds. That's going to be on Saturday, May the 1st. Ticket buyers will receive a meal which includes salad, meat, potatoes, and dessert. Local singer Dan McCarty will provide the entertainment. You get all that. They're $35 each per ticket, or you can get a table for eight at a discounted rate of $250. If you want to get tickets to that, and I think they're going fast, you call Angie Eisenogle or text her. Her number is 740-418-5017, 740-418-5017. All proceeds will benefit projects at the fairgrounds and the Jackson County Fair, and that's exactly what all those proceeds will go to from the flea market this past weekend. On the sports side, we want to tell you that it finally happened. The Jackson Ironman baseball team lost a game. They won on
Friday.
Yeah, barely. They won on Friday against Chillicothe in a league game
they
to
did.
Go to 11-0. But then on Saturday night at the VA, they played a big school out of the Cincinnati area named Lakota East. Josh McGraw wanted to make the schedule a little harder, have this challenge. They lost that game 9-7. I don't know any details other than the fact they lost, and Lakota East was the opposition. But it was expected to be one of their big challenges of the year. They lost 9-7.
Well, Lakota East is also in the upper division. They're a Division I school.
They are a Division I school. There's a Lakota East and a Lakota West, and they're some of the larger suburban schools in the Cincinnati area.
Yeah.
Don't know about the quality of their baseball team, but I guarantee you they had a lot of boys to pick from.
All right.
Tonight, speaking of the Ironmen, they'll be back in action. I'm sure eager to get back on the winning track, but it's a big challenge, Jennifer. They're playing Miami Trace at home at 5 o'clock. We'll, of course, have that game on 105.3 FM and 1330 Fox Sports AM station. Myself and Dan Morrow will be there to bring you that action. It's a big game. It's a Frontier Athletic Conference game. Right now, the Ironmen are in first place, one game ahead of these same Miami Trace Panthers and one game ahead of Hillsboro. So Jackson right now is on track for a championship if they don't stub their toe, but there's still six games to play, so there's a lot of games to play. This game tonight will be a big one as Miami Trace is just a step behind them. Miami Trace has only lost one game this year, and that was to Jackson earlier in the season. Uh-oh. So they want a little revenge.
That's right.
So Jackson better be on its game.
Ooh, this will be a good one.
All right. Well, very good. It's time for me to go back downstairs and work on that Wednesday paper.
Well, thank you, Pete.
It was not always nice to come up and visit you, Jennifer.
It's always nice to talk with you as well, Pete. All right. Pete's Morning News Update brought to you by Nia Henry, agent for Appalachia Realty. If you are looking to buy or sell or have any real estate needs, give Nia a call, 740-418-4135. All right, let's head on over to our Zip Printing weather forecast, where you can, of course, pick up those graduation yard signs, banners, shirts, napkins, and more to commemorate your senior. Whether it be, as we said the other day, a preschool graduation on up through college and everywhere in between, give a shout out to your senior by visiting our friends at Zip Printing downstairs. You can go to zipprinting.carlsoncraft.com for those graduation announcements, and also your totalmedia.shop for all the signs, banners, and all of that fun stuff, t-shirts, all kind of cool stuff. All right. Weather forecast looking pretty good. Well, for today and tomorrow, and then we won't talk about after that. So for today, partly cloudy with highs around 68 degrees. For tonight, mostly clear, lows around 42. Then tomorrow on Tuesday, a little prettier, actually, mostly sunny with highs around 71 degrees. And you're not going to believe this, 71 degrees on Tuesday, and then on Wednesday, there is actually the S word back in the forecast again. We'll see. I don't believe it, but that pesky snow word does come back into the forecast, so we'll see. All right. Well, our good friend Phil is here today, and he said he's ready to party, and we're going to talk about, well, we don't know what we're going to talk about. Fun stuff.
Yeah, preferably.
So, Phil, how are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you so much for asking. And anything in the news that you wanted to talk about today that you know that we can share the skinny with our viewers?
Well, I'm waiting to verify the actual numbers, but I know I've spoken in the past about the rate increases in the city of Wellston after they had their updated five-year RCAP study. This pertains to the water and sewer rates in the city. They did discuss that a little bit on last Thursday night during the council meeting. They have not taken a vote yet through council, but they did send that to a committee. I think it was the Finance Committee, which is headed by the mayor, Charlie Hudson's brother, Councilman Rick Hudson. I don't want to say for sure what the numbers are yet, not that it really matters. This is just their recommendation to the full council for them to take a vote, which I would anticipate would happen at their next meeting, would be the first part of May. But I know that the recommended rate increase from the RCAP study, which is, you know, a third-party study, had no one involved with it from the city. They were recommending, I believe, a $275 per month per customer rate increase for water rates for the term of 5 years, and then I believe it was $1.50 or $1.75 for sewer over the course of 3 years per customer per month. And I believe what Councilman Hudson said last Thursday evening was that their committee had decided to go with a $1.50 increase for water and a 50% or 50 cent increase for sewer. I don't want to stand by those numbers yet. I'm waiting to get those confirmed from the mayor, who was actually out of the office at the latter part of last week for a medical procedure. But I do know for a fact that they are recommending a 10% discount for senior citizens in the city. That would be across the entire utility bill, which is water, sewer, and trash. But again, like I said, these are all things that would have to be presented to the full council for a vote. And more than likely, they won't try to get that through in an emergency fashion. They'll probably have three readings on that, since the meetings are open again to the public, so someone could come in and express their concerns if they have any. So we're watching that as I have been for quite a while now. So that will probably be coming out to the full council, like I said, at the beginning part of next month.
Well, let's just be honest, Phil. Nobody wants to pay more for anything, you know.
No.
But also, it has to be reasonable. And
that's I wanted to note that. I'm glad you said that, because the reason why they went away from what the actual recommendation was, which those numbers, you know, don't sound like a whole lot, but when you add those up over the course of 5 years,
sure,
that's quite a bit of money.
Yes.
And they try to keep it, according to the representative from RCAP, when they presented the full study, he said they try to keep it at or below 2% of the median household income, which in Wellston isn't a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I would say it's between $40,000 and $50,000 annually. So them doing those rate increases as they were recommended would be up around 2.3% of the median household income, which the finance committee members felt was just a little too much. That what they recommended was right at about 2% of the median household income. So like I said, once I verify those numbers this morning, I'm going to talk to Mayor Hudson probably shortly after I go downstairs from here and get started on that. Hopefully I'll have a story in for Wednesday's paper.
Very good. And that's the great thing about the paper and the local news here. You all keep us updated and as quickly as possible. So thank you.
We do our best. You're welcome.
That's exactly right. All right. Anything else?
I don't know what Pete talked about. Did he talk about the big bombshell event from last week? I don't know a lot about it, so I don't really want to say too much about it with the local attorney.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah, we did discuss that. And you know, not to revisit it, but we did discuss a little bit about, too, like what an indictment means versus, mm-hmm, you know, I think when it's a high profile case and something like that happens in our area and people start hearing words like that, they don't sometimes know exactly what that means. So we did talk a little bit about, you know, someone being indicted versus convicted and charged. And, you know, they're you hear all these words and, oh, my goodness. But indicted means there's enough evidence to go to trial, basically.
Yeah.
Or the grand jury believes so. So that's where we're at with that one.
Yeah. And those allegations go back a while. And he did turn himself in. I think that's important to note, too. They didn't have to go find him or anything like that.
Sure.
So, I mean, these are all allegations at this point. It's got to be hard for his family and friends. So just try to keep an open mind and realize that, you know, it's supposed to be you're innocent until you're proven guilty. So we'll see how this plays out.
Sure. Absolutely. And again, it's like I said, living in a small town's a blessing and a curse. And,
yeah,
and you know, when everybody knows everybody, then it gets real weird real fast.
Yeah, it really does.
And that's just my opinion. That's not. But that's also fact. So
yeah,
it gets real weird.
I mean, it's just part of the job, but I've never really enjoyed writing up crime logs or covering, you know, court cases or anything like that. It's just because, I mean, there are whole documentaries about trial by media. I mean, it's an unfortunate side effect of having that out there in the public for everyone to see and hear. Mm-hmm. But you have to keep in mind that, you know, no matter how bad the allegations, they are allegations at this point. We have to wait and see what happens, you know, in the court before anyone makes up their minds.
Absolutely. And I'm glad you pointed that out. Although our national media doesn't seem to give two cares about influencing people, but that's a whole other story.
Yeah, it's not our job to make you feel any certain way. It's our job to tell you what happened, and then you can decide how you feel about it. That's the way an impartial journalist is supposed to be.
Well, supposed to be.
Yeah.
So I think our local news team right here does a fantastic job. You guys are great.
I appreciate that.
All right, speaking of James, okay, you have not seen this. James and I have seen this morning. We want you to tell us, all our viewers, what is this? Are you ready? What is that?
Oh. Is it a fox?
Mm.
I can't really see it.
Can you play it again? It's become a national news debate or a national debate.
It looked like a fox when it first ran right there. Well, never mind. It's a little bit too long to be a fox.
Uh-huh.
I don't know.
Neither
some
does
sort of
anyone
a jungle
else.
Cat?
So this happened down in Florida, and this is this lady's surveillance video. And I agree with her. I think it looks like a velociraptor. So it's become this huge thing where people think a little dinosaur ran across their yard. And if you watch it, it runs just like on Jurassic Park, the velociraptor.
If we're, well, I mean, I can't say I'd be surprised.
I know, right? Flipping COVID, man. Yeah. Now we got dinosaurs running around. So she posted this video, and people are like losing their minds. So some people, she says, basically any animal we can come up with that would be walking at 3:40 in the morning wouldn't walk this way. Maybe I've watched Jurassic Park too many times, but I see a raptor or a small dinosaur. This is the lady that it was her video. Some say a large bird, but that makes no sense. Whatever it is has front legs as well as
the
hind
legs. See,
I couldn't
see it. I could just see it. Yeah. Wow.
Doesn't it? Like, you could totally see where someone would get dinosaur out of that.
Definitely, especially the tail.
Yes, and that's the whole thing. It's that big, thick tail.
That is so strange.
And it's running so fast.
Yeah.
So some people are like, oh, it's a Komodo dragon, or it's a, you know, whatever. Okay, but they don't
stand like that, and they're really low to the ground.
They're really low to the ground, and I don't know that they run that fast. So,
I don't know. Just don't live in Florida, I guess.
I don't know. It's freaking me out, though. So someone wrote, looks like a Komodo dragon or some type of lizard. Someone else wrote, unless Fred Flintstone lost control of Dino, that's someone's pet on a leash. Someone else wrote, Jurassic World is for real. And even Orlando Universal Studios posted on their social media, a new ride, the Jurassic World Velocicoaster, is scheduled to open in June. Quickly counts all of the raptors. So, I don't know, man. What is it?
That's very strange.
All right, I've got another video for you, Jen.
Okay.
I'd just be happy that this isn't what was going on.
No.
There's your Komodo dragon.
Oh, it's shopping.
Those things are terrifying.
Ew. Oh, no.
Aren't those the ones, like, if they bite you, don't they have some weird bacteria in their teeth that can kill you?
I don't know.
Where is that?
This is in Thailand.
Okay.
Oh, nuh-uh. No.
Just be grateful we don't live somewhere that has those.
We have whole council meetings about cats, so at least we're not dealing with this. Things can always be worse.
Bring that up to council. Yeah, what are we going to do with this thing?
That's a sense of perspective if I ever saw one.
I don't know. I mean, I guess that could be something. I mean, I guess if those things run that fast, that could be something like that. But that's the closest thing to a dinosaur-looking thing that I've ever seen.
Yeah.
So James brought up this interesting story today. We were talking off the air about this. And you were saying that, what was it, the guy?
So all the artistic renderings of dinosaurs that we have are based on their skeletons.
Mm-hmm.
But that, of course, doesn't take into consideration things like fat that wouldn't last millions of years.
Right.
So this artist, he took a skeleton of like a camel, an elephant, and a humpback whale, and gave the artist like a photo of their skeleton and had him draw them based on their skeleton.
Only.
And long story short, what they drew looked nothing like the real animal. Mm. So what he's suggesting is that dinosaurs probably look a lot different than we think they look because we're not taking fat into consideration.
Right. And like for example, you take a camel that has the humps, but in its skeleton or its bones, they wouldn't be there. So you would not know that a camel has that.
I had always wondered, because Parker will ask me, you know, my son will ask me sometimes, you know, if that's really what a dinosaur will look like, or what. I said, I don't know. I wasn't there. No one knows what they really looked like. So, yeah, I've always been curious as to what dinosaurs really did look like.
So here on the left, that is a camel skeleton, and on the right, that is a dinosaur skeleton. Oh. So you can see how the skeleton doesn't represent the hump in any way.
Right. So there you go. That's just one example of many animals.
So here's a whale skeleton. So you can see if it didn't have all the fat that it has, it would just look like a giant tadpole.
Right.
Oh, interesting.
That is really, really
cool.
And
then freaky. One more to show you. Jen's saying that thing in the security camera video looked like a velociraptor.
Yeah.
Just give me a second.
Well, whatever they looked like in Jurassic Park anyway. Yeah. I don't really know what it looked like in real life.
So
I hope I never know.
I know. Those were the scary ones.
All right. So on the left, that is a velociraptor skeleton. And on the right, that is a pigeon skeleton.
Oh.
Okay, that's creepy. They look exactly the same.
Yeah. So a lot of people think that velociraptors were, one, smaller than they were in Jurassic Park, and two, much more bird-like and probably had feathers and maybe even
flightless wings. It looks very, very similar.
So it was just a big pigeon then.
A lot of people think that.
Well, pigeons don't eat people.
They just eat whatever's laying on the sidewalk.
They just eat everything else. Yeah.
Well, that lady just had like a 6-foot-long pigeon in her backyard. That's all. Still terrifying, nonetheless.
Yeah, whatever that was running through that yard. I'm sorry, but so it seems to me with the technology that we have today that somebody could take that video and like clean it up. And
I'm pretty sure it was just the Mothman's dog.
Maybe. Listen, there was something to that Mothman thing. People were seeing something. Everybody can't tell the same story, and
that's the one thing. There were a lot of stories that were similar, and they were
and people that didn't know each other,
yeah.
and
in some cases it was entire countries apart. I mean, it wasn't just in West Virginia or Point Pleasant where they saw that. I mean, they've had sightings of the Mothman all over the place.
I don't know.
And in different cultures and different eras, and it's strange.
Now, you know, you get into the, did it cause the bridge to collapse, or was it warning people of that, or, you know, you get into all that, and I guess that could all be debated. But people are seeing something.
Yeah.
And the fact that their descriptions are eerily similar, it's kind of like the Bigfoot. I don't know what they're seeing, but they're seeing something.
Right. Yeah. I mean,
I'm not going to discount anything.
Exactly. It is hard to discount anything. I don't know anything. I've only been alive for 35 years. I don't know anything.
Like, who are we to say that there aren't things, you know, how arrogant are we to think that there's not life out there somewhere else, that we're the only entities that could.
We haven't even finished searching our own planet yet.
I mean,
we don't know what's in the water, so. It's really hard to discredit anybody's
arrogant
sightings.
Dum-dums. No, and I can tell you, and I've said this many, many times on this program, I can sit out on my front porch and see some weird lights and stuff go over my, and I mean, I've seen it numerous, numerous times, like stuff that I can't explain, like lights in a triangle. I've seen numerous times, just weird, weird stuff. Or like something is here, and then the next thing you know, it's there. And
I've
you're
seen
like,
that before, too. There's no way something could go that fast.
How did it get from there to there and you didn't see it? Like, I don't know. There's some weird stuff. So is it military craft? I don't know.
I just hope somebody's watching. I don't want to be responsible for that. But
right. What's up, Pete?
I'll just get right behind.
Okay.
Scoot you
over.
To tell you something. We were talking about the Mike Moore situation.
Hey, Pete, make sure you're talking to the microphone.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. We were talking about the Mike Moore situation.
Yes.
And you would ask about
you know, his law office and all his clients, what would happen there.
A lot of discussion.
I got that answer just after I left.
Oh, good. Okay.
Former Vinton County prosecutor Tricia Kimes Brown is actually working with Mike now, has since the first of the year, and so she will be handling all those cases. And for those people out in the public who had worked with Mike or long-term or even currently, his law practice will continue while this is going on, his criminal case is going on with Tricia Kimes Brown.
Oh, that's such good news, because I know that was a real concern for people.
Yeah.
Thank you.
He's got some high-profile cases out there right now, so I wondered that myself.
I think people, like, you know, I know a few people that he's representing right now, and their question to me was, well, now what? I'm like, I don't know. I'd have to think that this had been thought about ahead of time.
That's a rare situation, I would assume.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's like, oh, man, and you can't leave these people hanging, so
He's a very popular attorney.
Yes.
He's good at what he does.
He's very good at what he does, so. All right, well, that answers that, so super. All right, so small dinosaur or not? I don't know.
Pigeon. I'm sticking with pigeon.
Giant pigeon.
Going with giant pigeon?
Dinosaur, giant pigeon.
Last time I checked, a giant pigeon does not have a ginormous, big, fat, long tail following it behind it.
Well, it's a giant pigeon rat hybrid.
Yeah, it's
is that what it is?
Yeah. It's a ridgin. Retigion.
I've never been to Florida, but I've ridden a New York. I've ridden a New York subway, so I know giant rat pigeon hybrids definitely exist.
Oh God! Hey, speaking of, did you guys see the story of that came out of Australia end of last week?
No.
Oh, so a mom from Australia shared photos on her Facebook of a bag of lettuce that her son and daughter-in-law had opened. And this bag of lettuce, I don't know if James has the picture or not, they bought it at Aldi. This is in Australia. A highly, highly deadly venomous snake in it. So they open up this bag of lettuce and this snake pops out.
Like every other snake in Australia.
There it is.
Oh, my gosh.
No, thank you.
I just think we should take a second to recognize how much more stuff Aldi in Australia has for sale than they do in America.
Just like, they typed, you know, like, check packages of lettuce carefully. Last night, my son found a baby pale-headed snake lettuce from Aldi, and it shows the snake, like, in the video. You can see it slithering around in the bag. It is a poisonous snake.
No way.
Evidently, in Queensland, Australia, someone spotted a snake in a bathroom drain of a restaurant. I don't know what they're doing there in Australia, but...
They've got some of the weirdest, wildest, deadliest creatures on the planet right there on that little island, and I never want to go there. Ever.
They do. But yet, I don't know. I just, if I'm going to go, I'm calling Crocodile Dundee, and he'll just take care of it for me. I mean, he'd just, like, reach in and grab that snake and...
I'm not that afraid of snakes here. I mean, but over there, I mean, every other one is poisonous. I mean, most of the snakes here won't harm you a bit. There's nothing really to be afraid of.
Right.
Like, I mean, unless you find a copperhead, but...
Or a rattlesnake.
Or a rattlesnake. There are some temper.
Yeah, well, speak for yourself. This girl didn't know she was afraid of snakes until I encountered one in my yard, and I froze like a popsicle.
So they also have spiders like this.
Look at that.
No.
That's
James.
I can't do that. I would burn my house down.
That's what I said last week, Jen. Like, Australia looks beautiful, but like,
no way. I would burn my house to the ground if that was in it.
Everyone out.
Yeah, I would just cut my losses.
Blow it up. Yeah, I don't know about that.
I want to know how that thing got in the house. I mean, you had to have had the door open for that thing to come in.
Yeah, that didn't like squeeze through the cracks.
No.
I don't think.
Insane. That thing's as big as my head.
I don't know. That looks like a Halloween decoration that you get at Odd Lots. Mm-hmm. Like,
Well, then, like, I remember talking to Commissioner Haller about his time when he was in Iraq during the first Gulf War, mm-hmm. and those camel spiders that they would have, that they bite you when you're asleep, and they have like some sort of numbing agent in their venom, and they would just slowly, and their bacteria like eats away at your skin.
Oh.
And they're humongous. They're huge.
All right,
so you wouldn't even know they were biting you.
Ready for another Australian spider, Jen?
No, I'm not.
Oh, my gosh. That looks like a crab.
No, not okay.
That makes me not ever want to eat crab again because it makes me think that crabs are just the spiders
just
of the sea.
Giant spider.
They're just spiders of the
There's
sea.
Spider web in my crab legs.
They're spiders of the sea. I just had crab legs last night.
If you
did you?
Yeah.
Were spider legs. I don't care. They tasted good.
You had a water spider.
A water spider.
And shrimp are like the cockroaches of the sea.
I mean, let's just be honest. Lobster is in the cockroach family.
Yeah. Shrimp too. And the shrimp eat like the most disgusting things in the ocean.
Uh-huh.
And then we eat them.
Yeah.
I love shrimp, but the older I get, the more I start to think about those things.
I know.
And I don't want to eat anything, really. I don't want to eat anything. You can't even eat lettuce now. You have a snake.
I know. A giant venomous snake's going to pop out and get you.
Please. You know where I've never found a snake? In cookies. Just eat cookies. Snake wouldn't fit in there, and if it was in there, you'd see it.
Yeah, and I've never found a snake in a can of beer either.
Hey, that's true.
Just saying. There you go.
Cookies and beer.
I like it. NASA had a great thing happen. They're in... Ingenuity Mars helicopter made history with its first powered controlled flight on Mars.
Wow.
Pretty cool. It's that little drone helicopter that they have up there. And it actually, the whole flight was expected to last around 40 seconds. It lifted off, climbing at a rate of 3 feet per second. It has a 13 megapixel camera and it hovers at 10 feet above the surface. It has performed its first flight, the first flight of a powered aircraft on another planet. And the cool thing about it is it has solar panels on it, so it recharges itself.
That is so neat that they can power something like that so far away.
Yeah, can you believe that? Yeah. We've been talking for so long about a Wright Brothers moment. That's the project manager. I can't pronounce their name. And here it is. The $85 million helicopter demo was considered high risk, yet high reward. They've been aiming for a 40-second flight, and the craft hit all its targets. Spin up, take off, hover, descent, and landing.
Very cool.
Yep.
I feel like $85 million is a deal for a space helicopter.
I know, for a helicopter that can literally jump off something and land itself on Mars. And
I mean, how much does like a regular passenger airplane cost to make?
That's a good point.
Yeah, like what does a Boeing 747 cost to make? So its rotor blades spin at 2,500 revolutions per minute. 5 times faster than on Earth, with an atmosphere just 1% the thickness of Earth's, engineer had to build a helicopter light enough and the blades spin fast enough to generate lift because the atmosphere is so different there. But it also has to withstand the severe cold and wind that's on Mars.
Wow.
I don't know. If Matt Damon can do it,
do you think it can grow its own
potatoes?
I don't
know if it's going to grow its own potatoes or not.
Elon will be up there soon,
dude,
with plenty of potatoes for everyone.
Can you imagine? I can't wait for space potatoes. Arby's is just going to be all over that. They've got the curly fries. They've got the sweet potato fries. They got the crinkle fries. And now they got the space fries.
Space potatoes.
Space buds.
Space buds.
Space
tots. Space spuds. I love it. Oh, well. No, that is, I mean, you got to give them credit. That's some pretty cool stuff.
How smart do you have to be able to figure all that stuff out?
So, yeah. So I'm sitting there watching this morning. Of course, you know, there's like, you know, the NASA control and they're all sitting there waiting for this to happen. And I'm like, how smart are all of you people in that room right now? And how did you get that job?
Yeah.
Like.
Yep.
Mind blown.
Yep.
Insanity, I tell you.
It took me a half an hour to change my light bulb in my car the other day. So, yeah, I'm not going to be working for NASA anytime soon.
I'm not flying any helicopters on Mars. Just no. Saying. Not going to happen.
Nope.
Well, and who's the guy that actually is, like, holding the control? Because it's like a drone, right?
Yeah.
Like, what if you crashed it?
That'd be a very expensive mistake.
Oopsie.
Yeah. I wonder how many they did crash before they put the news out that they were successful. They probably ran through five or six before
Fair
they
question.
Said
it.
It's like Charlie Brown with all this kite stuck in a tree. Yeah. It's just like $80 million Mars rover drones stuck in a space tree.
Yeah. Stuck in a space tree. Are there any trees on Mars?
A couple thousand years
from now. Well, we're about to find out.
We're fixing to find out.
Yeah. Well, here's my question, Jen.
Yes.
When Arch and Eddie's gets the space fries, what toppings are you going to put on the loaded space fries?
Ooh.
What is it? Pimento cheese? Is that what Courtney likes
we'll
so much?
We'll go with pimento cheese.
Gonna have pimento cheese and space fries.
100%.
That chicken sandwich you guys have with the pimento cheese is dangerous. Say that.
Yep, the southern fried sandwich. Yes.
Wait until you try it with space fries.
Yeah. Just wait. Then we can make it with space chicken.
You could do a promotion where your waitresses all dress like astronauts.
Martians are walking around.
They walk around like there's no gravity.
Everybody thinks someone in your cook staff ate a bunch of mushrooms. You start walking around like that.
Hey, it will prevent COVID.
If you have to wear a mask anywhere, you might as well just wear
an astronaut suit. Yeah, I mean, why not wear a space suit?
Have some fun with it.
Oh my god, you guys are too much. All right, we got to get out of here. Hey, I stopped by Carmen's yesterday and drove around the lot. I had some time and I was just driving by. I thought I'm just gonna drive in there and take a look at some of those vehicles that he has. So he has several large passenger vans right now. So if you have like a church group or something like that you need to haul people around, he definitely has several of those on the lot, all different shapes and sizes and that kind of stuff. So stop out and see them at Carmen's, and you'll be glad that you did. Four-door Jeep Wrangler on the lot. He still has that Volkswagen Beetle. It's adorable. I stopped and looked at it. Many gas-saving vehicles, all that stuff. Also did want to thank our friends at the Filling Station, the store at Broadway and Penn and Wellston, and Quick Stop. You know, it's going to be beautiful the next couple of days. How about you head up and do that loop around Lake Elma, and then you can stop by the store at Broadway and Penn, and you can get some Hoser's Pizza or just grab those convenient items that you need. Salads, subs, sandwiches, all the fun stuff that they have to offer there. Make a stop by and see what we're talking about. All right, boys, are you guys ready to get out of here for the day?
Real quick.
Yes.
Commissioner Hensler wanted to chime in.
Yes.
And said he thought that it was a bobcat in the video. I figured I would share that. He just sent me a text a couple minutes ago.
A bobcat.
So that's what he's sticking with.
Okay.
It's pretty unimaginative.
Yeah, I didn't
bobcat
say it, John.
In Florida.
It's definitely space pigeon rat.
Space pigeon rat.
Space.
Indeed.
It's a sprat. I don't know. Oh, God. Get us out of this, please. Somebody hit a button and turn us off. we appreciate y'all tuning in, and we will be right back here tomorrow. So enjoy some beautiful weather today and tomorrow, because Wednesday, it's all downhill. So get out and about. We'll see you back here tomorrow. Thanks for watching. Bye, everyone.
Space pigeon rat.